Used to drive all night in your father's car. Used to get lost in time. Where did it all go wrong? We used to kiss all night, staying up till the dawn. Used to get lost in time. Where did it all go wrong? Standing on the mountain, can you hear?
Welcome to Westlife Back Home. Now, over the next half hour, we'll reflect on 10 years at the top for Northern Ireland's favourite pop act ever. We'll meet the fans, plus a very special fan, and of course, we'll get up close and personal with Westlife themselves. In July 1998, five would-be pop stars kick-started a career that would see them become one of the music industry's top-selling acts. They had the looks, the ambition, and the talent, something that was quickly recognised by the right people.
I knew within 30 seconds of seeing them for the first time, I was going to sign them to a record deal. I wanna
know. After the band was chosen and, you know, the final lineup was ready to roll, that was probably the most exciting part of it all, really, you know, the first time to ever go to a recording studio, record a song, even hear a song that we were going to be recording, I suppose, was such a big thrill to us.
It was a bit weird when I first got into the studio because I was almost a bit disappointed because it kind of questioned my confidence a little bit, you know, because I didn't get it straight away. Just look around
and all of the people that we used to know. We had to kind of be different, you know, there was a lot of different bands out there at the time and, you know, I think Five were the big boy band at the time and they were very kind of, you know, they were rapping and dancing and different things like that and they were brilliant, you know, they had a lot of success at the time, but for us we had to be different.
We did sort of focus from day one on the vocals, you know, and that was something that was just natural, really. It wasn't something that's, it's not a marketed thing or whatever, it's just the way we are.
Well, it was Simon Cowell who offered the boys that all-important recording contract. It was Boyzone's manager, Louis Walsh, who was preparing Westlife as pop's next big thing.
To have Louis behind us was everything. And if I was going to make this step and really devote my life and give up everything to being a pop band, I really had to believe in it. And I think with what Boyzone had done, and we're continuing to do with Louis involved, that was the way to do it.
They watched bands like Five and Blue and A1 just come and go. So they did not want to be like those bands. They wanted to be like Take That, you know, and last forever. It's all about being successful.
That success was instant as the band's debut single, Swear It Again, went straight to the top of the UK charts and went on to become an international hit.
Swear It Again was a massive hit for us all over the world and it was different, it was very different for a band to come out with a song like that at the time. There wasn't many ballad singing boys or whatever, or groups or whatever at the time. So for us it was different and we set our mark straight away.
I remember the first day that I got Swear It Again in my hand and played it on the show. And I listened to the first verse of it before I played it on the radio. And I remember what I said, I held the CD in my hand, went live on the air, and I said, this is a band who are going to be massive.
First time I actually saw them or heard them, I thought, you know, is this a Boyzone derivative? Is it just Boyzone been played out? Is Louis pulling the strings here and putting just something together? I'd be honest, the first time I heard them, I thought, this would be a one-hit wonder.
Whenever the first song, Swear It Again, was released, it was going to be a success. You know, it was radio-friendly, it was safe enough, it appealed to their market. It did what it said on the tin, and it went to number one, and it was the first of many.
With song after song hitting the top spot, Westlife were laying the groundwork for the huge success to come. The band had well and truly arrived.
To be honest with you, that first album, you know, the five singles that were chosen off that album, that was what did it all.
All the singles of the first album, I think, were very strong. And I think, even more importantly, they weren't the same song over and over again. They were all different, but they all had sort of a sound that was in every one of them.
I think the early songs like If I Let You Go, they created this kind of Westlife sound. Everybody knew, once you hear a record on the radio, think, that's Westlife.
Can't believe that I'm a fool again. They
they were releasing classic pop songs. I also think that the fact that they came across as, you know, lovely Irish blokes, I think they really had the full package.
The band's fan base has always been diverse, with every hit single bringing new devotees on board. You see, everybody loves a bit of Westlife, from Teeny Bopper to Taoiseach.
The good thing about the lads is, they can all sing, they can sing well. And, the great advantage of that is it's gone down well with the audience, it's gone down well with record sales. I suppose that's where people vote with their feet.
What would be, if you could pin one down, your favourite Westlife song?
Flying Without Wings. Everybody's looking for that something. It was original, it was nice. I think they sang it particularly well. They sang a lot of them particularly well, but it suited their shows very well.
As well as having a Prime Minister for a fan, Westlife also now had an anthem that set them apart from many of their boy band contemporaries. This Record of the Year winner perfectly showcased their considerable vocal talents and was a pivotal moment in Westlife's history.
Flying Without Wings obviously was definitely probably the best song of our career. Little did we know at the time it was, but we knew it was a great song. And it had been a big hit for us.
It was the song that certainly maybe took us away a wee bit in the music industry's eyes and in the media's eyes and stuff like that from the typical boy band scenario. You know, it was like, oh, hold on a second. Here's a mature song that's amazing lyrics, amazing vocals, big sounding gospel choir, massive production. It wasn't necessarily your instant, bam, here's the chorus of the song, you know what I mean? It's a slow burn and one that you listen to forever. You're
flying without wings. Flying Without Wings was never a cheesy ballad. It was, it could have been a hit for anybody. And thankfully it was ours.
The bottom line on all Westlife songs is that they soar with emotion. And I think that was a pretty powerful song. And it's like flying
without wings. Everyone always goes on about the high note and Flying Without Wings. That note actually was the bane of my life for so long because I was thinking about it too much and I was like, here comes the note, and then I'd end up totally messing it up because I'd be thinking about it so hard or whatever. Nowadays I just kind of let it happen or whatever, Flying without
wings. Of course, with all that success came fame. The five lads from Sligo and Dublin were now major pop stars and big-time celebrities, whether they liked it or not.
It was never about fame for me. Fame is something I can very easily, kind of have or not have. It doesn't really... Obviously, having fame in your life is a very weird thing, and until you have it, you don't really know what it's like. Sometimes it can be an absolute pain in the backside. Other times it can be all right. It makes life easier for you, shall we say. But at the same time, it's something that I never really desired. I didn't want to be famous, I didn't get into Westlife because I wanted to be famous.
The whole pop star thing and the whole fame side of things, I used to fight against it quite a lot. Everyone was like, you're going to be so big and famous and you're on this magazine and that TV show. And in a way, I didn't like it because it kind of separated me from my friends and my family, if you know what I mean. People pushed me as being something different to them, and I was like, but no, I'm not. It was just me being kind of a young lad from Sligo and not wanting my life to change, because I loved my life. And I was scared of the big fame and fortune and kind of success thing coming in and just turning it on its head,
While the rest of our mates were going to college, we were on a tour bus traveling around, Ireland and the UK, and then all of a sudden we were into Germany and Sweden recording albums and working with these guys that, like, Britney was in the day before us and NSYNC the day after us, and we were shuffling around, it was very surreal. Let me go
home. Nowhere is adulation for Westlife stronger than in Northern Ireland, where a record amount of sell-out shows helped the band sell over 500,000 records here. That's almost a third of the population.
The fan base in Northern Ireland it's crazy. They've supported us from day one. They're, probably one of the most loyal fan bases in the world. They're literally there. They never miss a trick.
There's a lot of places in the world that we can go to that we're successful in and walk down the street and go into a shop and buy a packet of crisps and walk back out. You can't do that in Northern Ireland.
the Northern Irish fans, they're famously like mad in the good way, you know, they're famously like really kind of loud and passionate. One of them will always kind of go a bit further and go nuts.
To be outside the hotels, singing World of Rowan at 4 a.m. in the morning after the first show, you know, you do the first show in the Odyssey, you go back, you have a few drinks, and you'd be still hearing World of Rowan at 3 or 4 a.m. and you're like, this is amazing.
The people to the north took to them, and they took to the people in the north, and they loved going back there. They loved going back to the TV shows, they loved going back to Odyssey. I think they hold a record for anybody been appearing so many times in Odyssey.
They've done 45 concerts at the arena, which is phenomenal, with another three this month. The next nearest artist has probably done six with us, you know, and looking at the facts, I think that's one in every six concerts been by Westlife, which is unbelievable.
Westlife in Belfast alone have sold over 400,000 tickets. Like, there's nobody that has ever sold that. And there probably never will be another act like Westlife to sell that amount of tickets.
Every time we arrive, say, back in the days when we were doing the Kelly show and just anything really in Belfast, there's always a major presence of fans.
The minute we announced that Westlife was going on Kelly, I would have had minimum 500 kids queuing up from 12 o'clock that day outside UTV. They were enormous.
From a radio point of view, you just have to play Westlife now. From one point of view, that in Northern Ireland, if you don't play Westlife, you turn off the transmitter and go home.
Their fans queuing up outside the Odyssey waiting for tickets hours, days and weeks before they're due to go on sale. I mean, that level of commitment from an audience member is unbelievable.
One thing that is distinctive about Northern Ireland, there's still that kind of pandemonium up there, you know? I mean, for us to drive in somewhere in a car and to have people going nuts, it's definitely still like something that gives you a buzz.
Westlife are popular in Belfast because from day one, they've always played Belfast. They've always gone to Belfast to promote themselves. They do signings. They almost know a lot of the fans' names. I think that's the secret, is that they're down-to-earth nice guys.
If I want to bring the lads for a night out, I'd probably go to Belfast before I go to Dublin.
Something about Belfast just gives you goosebumps, definitely.
Coming up in part two, Cian tells it like it is.
I thought the band was over. I was the first one to say.
Find out who Shane is talking about here.
No offence, but we don't care about them.
But now we've been hearing all about these Northern Ireland super fans, so before we take a quick break, I think we should meet a few. All dressed up.
Westlife 7 times.
I've seen Westlife 7 times every year they've been in Belfast.
I've been there every year from 2001. I haven't missed a tour.
I've seen Westlife 8 or 9 times.
I've seen them 32 times in the Odyssey.
They're absolutely amazing. They're the best band ever.
Ever.
I just love them.
Yeah, my favourite Westlife member is Nikki because I just love him, as you can see.
Cian Egan. Just so gorgeous, I love him so much.
This is where I met Nikki last year.
Because I've like met Nikki loads. So every time he comes out, he does that wee smack. Oh my god.
We scream the loudest.
We scream the loudest.
This is my sign shirt with me and Shane.
I'm the number one fan in the universe.
And Shane was really lovely. And he got out of the car and I was crying.
They're just so natural, so great, so kind.
It was just an amazing day. I'll never ever forget it. Thank you, Shane.
Very welcome.
Welcome back. So, Westlife are making records, breaking records. They're enjoying number one after number one, selling out tours everywhere. In fact, life in Westlife is perfect, right? Wrong.
You know, it's very, very hard to kind of juggle two lives when you've got a family and, you know, being in a band like Westlife, it is a huge commitment. And to be honest, for the last year, especially since Lily was born, I haven't really been able to commit 100% to Westlife. And I haven't been able to commit 100% to my family. So I kind of felt it was unfair on both. And I just felt it was the right time for me to kind of stand back.
When Brian left, it was a very big shock to us. You know, when he came in and told us that night, we actually thought we were being punked. But he said, no, I'm not punking you lads. It's what I want to do. I want to leave the band.
I thought the band was over. I was the first one to say. We were all sitting in that apartment in Dublin when he told us, and he left, and I just went, band's over, lads.
As straightforward and kind of you know, instant Brian is, he's also kind of quite a complex character, and I don't think anyone still knows exactly why. And to be honest with you, I don't know if Brian's even delved into his own mind to see exactly why he left.
Brian left because he wasn't happy, you know, and we didn't know, to be honest, how unhappy he was. He never let on, and he obviously had problems in his marriage that we had no clue about.
I didn't have a resentful bone in my body for when Brian decided to leave, because being in Westlife wasn't the easiest thing in the world.
That was the scariest time, you know. It was, it just felt like it didn't feel like the right time to, for me, and I knew from the other three guys, excluding Brian, that I didn't, you know, this wasn't supposed to be. We hadn't planned it like this. We hadn't, you know, we talked about years, including Brian, we talked about the next step and the next step.
For about 3 or 4 seconds, I thought, oops, Brian's gone, what are we going to do? And then I thought, no, we're going to keep this band together.
That was it. We were a four-piece, and it was either pull our socks up or keep them down and go home.
We'd like to start off by thanking you, Brian.
We did that big press conference where he left, which we should have never done. I cried, which I should have never done.
The last 5 days have been a huge strain on all of us, and only us five and Louis will ever understand that.
I was at the press conference, and Kian did this kind of iconic moment in Westlife's history now, where he stood up and he read out this letter to Brian, a personal message to Brian about how he felt. I couldn't help but think, you know, those aren't necessarily tears for how much you'll miss Brian, which I know they were genuine tears in that respect, but I think that was more for they were worried for themselves. Westlife were worried about their future. They were scared. They were tears of fear.
I think we glorified him too much when he left the band. You know, he left the band because he didn't want to be a member of Westlife, and we respect him for that. He did what he had to do for him, but we shouldn't have glorified him on it.
We wish you, Curry, Molly and Lily all the very best in your career and family life in the future. And for one last time, Brian, from the bottom of our hearts, we love you.
Got up and left them as a four-piece, and Kerry was actually sat literally on the seat next to me watching the whole thing, just in the middle of all the press, his wife Kerry Katona. She turned around to me and says, I hope to God he's not making the wrong decision here. And I thought that was a very telling moment, that maybe even Brian didn't know what he was doing.
It must have been really difficult for them to lose a key member, because Brian was the cute one or the funny one, and I think Westlife were at a critical position at that moment.
That's the good thing with having a five-piece. If one leaves, you can still keep it together as four. Brian was great. Yeah, we miss him, but the band goes on.
Anyway, now one man down, Westlife had to ride the storm and plan their next move. After a lukewarm response to an ill-advised Rat Pack album, the band needed a major hit, and fast. They got it with a song that had been recorded many times by various other artists. It just might have been the song that saved Westlife's career.
Raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy sea.
I think you raised me up. It was, I mean, well, who knows if it was a career-saving song or not, because we don't know what would have happened if we didn't have it, but it definitely was a song that picked us up from... It brought us right back up to the very top.
You Raise Me Up, probably one of the best songs we've ever done. It changed our career, that song, so we're very proud of it.
It was such a huge song for us. It was like a real kind of mark to say, listen, you know, we're still here, you know, don't be ruling the Westlife boys out just because they did a Rat Pack album last year and there's only four of us now. You know, it's like, we're still here, don't worry about it.
You raise me up so I can stand on mountains.
You Raise Me Up, we started to get the little kids back because there was that big chorus that little kids can just sing along to, so all of a sudden they're a Westlife fan again. I mean, these are kids that wouldn't know, like six-year-olds that, you know, You Raise Me Up was 6 years into our career. So they weren't born when Westlife was beginning. But all of a sudden, they loved this You Raise Me Up, and they were carrying, like, glow sticks or whatever.
It broke us into new territories, and the territories that we were already established in, it kind of solidified our name and put it right back up there, you know.
You raise me up.
You Raise Me Up is obviously, you know, it's a singular song that a lot of people here identify with and have taken it very much to their hearts for various reasons in Northern Ireland.
Westlife are very renowned for their ballads and for their love songs, and, you know, I just think it's a very strong pop tune.
You Raise Me Up certainly was the biggie, and that transformed. Other people had done it. But when Westlife did it, I think they did it brilliantly. I think they did justice to the song, and you can see why that appeals right across all generations.
You Raise Me Up may have done the trick, but it wasn't an original recording. One of the criticisms often levelled at the band. Another cover, another love song. You can't please all the people.
The Westlife fans are going to hate me for saying this, but I am so tired and fed up of playing Westlife love songs on the radio.
I think we all get a bit sick when we hear, oh God, it's another Westlife cover version coming out.
We've had the stigma attached to us now of doing covers only for the last 2 or 3 years. I mean, the first 3 years, 4 years of Westlife, I think we might have, out of probably 7 or 8 singles, maybe 2 of them were covers.
To be honest, we have done a lot of covers in the past 3, 4 years, and I understand why people would say that. And it's not something that we're happy about either. You know, we've had a lot of success because of it, but it's plain and simple. The songs weren't there for Westlife in the last 3 or 4 years.
I would like to hear a bit more of the up-tempo pop stuff that they had kind of mid-career. To me, that was their best period.
Westlife have taken a basic formula. It's like musical fast food.
You've got verse, chorus, verse, chorus. In the final verse, the key change. The bit when they get off the little stools and they stand to deliver the end.
And I like standing up in the key change because I actually sing better when I stand up.
It's maybe not my type of music, but I have been along to a few of the shows to review them. Love them or hate them, they put on a fantastic show.
Everybody loves a good Westlife tune. It's a guilty pleasure. I'm ashamed to say it, but even I have a good dance to them every now and again.
We don't care what the critics say, because the critics are usually failed kind of rock stars. You know, and they like these kind of guitar bands that don't sell any records. It's all about selling out big venues, selling out arenas worldwide. Who cares what the cool people think?
We're not, I suppose, drumming it down people's throats in any way. You don't have to buy the record if you don't want to. But there's an awful lot of people that do enjoy it.
There's a lot of people that Westlife don't please. But no offence, but we don't care about them.
Westlife, they are what they are. They sing big ballads with key changes, and it's a huge market, and they're the most successful at it.
It's not going to change the world. It's not going to save the world. It's not in any ways political. It's just nice pop music.
We're not songwriters. We're singers, and we've never been songwriters. And we do want better songs, and we've got them on this new album. Never thought that I'd be
so inspired. They certainly have. The current album, Back Home, has already sold over 50,000 copies in Northern Ireland, and it's only been available for 12 weeks. It's the band's finest hour so far, and bodes well for the future of Westlife.
This album is our best album, probably, that we've ever done. It's definitely in the top 2 or 3 albums that we've ever done. There's a lot of great songs and a lot of great singles to come from this album, and it's where we're going to go in the future.
With this album, we've gotten back to where we belong, really. You know, we've wanted for a long time to really make a great pop, original pop album.
It allows us to show the extra kind of bit that we have on maybe other pop singers, if you know what I mean. Which, and I know that might sound arrogant, but like, it's the, like, other bands have other things that they can do that we can't do. I mean, we're not the best dancers in the world, so this album, it gives us an opportunity to showcase that extra kind of few yards that we might have vocally on other bands.
We're taking a year off after this album for the first time in our career, and we're going to have a year and a half to find songs from now until we record our next album. So, you know, it better be our best album. I'm sure it will be.
You know, we got to be very careful of our song choice, of you know, where we're going. This is kind of like, we are now about to mark our territory for the future, because when we come back after this album, we've all said no more covers. There's not going to be another cover on the album. Now listen, you could show this interview in 2 years' time when we're releasing the next cover, I don't know. But that's where our brains are at the minute.
The four of us are very passionate about what we do. We want to stay around for a long time. We want to conquer the world as a pop band. What am I do without you?